Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the fifth meeting of the Social Justice and Social Security Committee. We have apologies this morning from James Dornan, and I welcome Evelyn Tweed, who will be a substitute for the committee today. Our first item of business is our first evidence session on the Charities Regulation and Administration Scotland Bill. The Charities Regulation and Administration Scotland Bill was introduced in the Scottish Parliament on the 15th of November 2022, following two consultation exercises by the Scottish Government in 2019 and 2021. The bill aims to strengthen and update the current legislative framework for charities by increasing transparency and accountability in charities, and it also aims to make improvements to OSCAR's powers and bring Scottish charity legislation up to date with certain key aspects of charity regulation in England, Wales and Northern Ireland. The committee held an informal engagement session on the bill yesterday with a range of individuals from across the third sector, as well as those representing accountancy and law firms. These discussions were a useful introduction to today's evidence and will help to inform members' scrutiny of the bill. A summary of those discussions will be available on the committee's website shortly. Turning back to today, I welcome to the meeting our first panel, Jason Henderson, Policy and Public Affairs Officer, Scottish Council for Voluntary Organisations, and Sarah Latto, Policy Officer, Volunteer Scotland, who are joining us in the room. And David Gibson, the Methodist Church's representative on the Scottish Churches Committee, Methodist Church in Scotland, Stephen Ingalls, Team Leader, Aberdeen City Council, and Madeleine Sproul, Solicitor, Church of Scotland, who are joining us remotely. Welcome all, and thank you for coming this morning. Just a few quick points to mention about the format of the meeting before we begin. Virtual witnesses, please wait until I or the member asking the question say your name before speaking. Again, virtual witnesses, I would ask please allow our broadcasting colleagues just a few seconds to turn your microphone on before we begin. Before you start to speak. Virtual witnesses can also indicate with an R in the dialogue box in blue jeans or simply with a show of your hand if you wish to come in a question. Please don't feel you all have to answer every single question. If you've nothing to add to what's been said by others, it's really okay. We do have a lot to get through this morning, so I would just ask everyone to keep questions, answers and any follow-up questions quite tight, please. Colleagues in the room should indicate to myself or the clerk if they wish to come in and ask a supplementary question. And committee members online should use the chat box or WhatsApp. So we will get started straight away, and I will turn first to our first theme, and questions from Pam Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you, convener, and good morning to the panel. Thank you for the evidence that you've given us in advance and for coming here this morning. I want to explore a little bit about how we've got to this point and the review that has been indicated as part of the development of this legislation. So the Scottish Government have said that they'll do this piece of legislation now, but they'll do a broader review in the future. First of all, have you been involved in the development of the proposals for the current legislation, and how would you characterise that? To Jason first, please.
So firstly, in terms of being involved in the process to date, SCVO have been heavily involved in that before my time as well. So we were involved in the original consultation in 2019, and then the engagement process in 2020-2021. So SCVO have been involved throughout that. I think I would highlight that obviously the proposals that the consultation engagement has been on were developed at the very beginning by OSCAR and the Scottish Government without input from SCVO or the sector. So very much that process has been specifically on these proposals that have been favoured by the regulator. Which I think kind of speaks to, you know, the increasing calls for a wider review, because there perhaps hasn't been that opportunity throughout this process to really discuss and debate what more could have been done. So I think in some areas of the sector there may be a belief that there's been an opportunity missed perhaps here. But that said, you know, we broadly support the bill and its aims and what it intends to do. In terms of a wider review, I think that firstly, SCVO have been calling for a wider review for quite some time, so we absolutely welcome the commitment from the Scottish Government. But I think what we would call for now is to make sure that that review is broad, is wide. I think that we need to remember that the 2005 Act isn't the only legislation that is of relevance. There are other forms of legislation. There's regulations, different regulators, duties, obligations, administrative processes, all of which make up the regulatory landscape in which charities and the wider sector operate within. And I think we need to keep that in mind. And I hope that the Scottish Government will commit to keeping that in mind as we see progress on that. And I think also for us, I think the review has to be independent. I think that we recognise that there is, you know, a wide swathe of opinion in terms of what this review could involve. But I think that the recommendations that come out of that need to be independently set and not crafted by government, and certainly not crafted by, you know, a handful of organisations such as ourselves. So that would be our take on both the review and the process to date. And the only other thing I would obviously stress is it would be good to, you know, start calling for timescales regarding a review from the Scottish Government as well.
Thank you, I appreciate that. I've got a supplementary to it, but I'll come back in a second. Sarah, do you have more to add?
Just to add that so Volunteer Scotland haven't had a policy function until quite recently, when I came into post in April last year. So we weren't involved in the earlier conversations around this bill. However, the fact that SEVO at COSVO and that their TSI colleagues were involved would, you know, the importance of volunteering was reflected, I think, within that. Having said that, I would echo quite a lot of what Jason said around the need for a wider review. We don't feel that the bill goes far enough in terms of trustee diversity and some of the challenges in that regard. So we do welcome that and would agree that it would be good to know what the timescales are around that review.
I appreciate that. Thank you. Is there anyone online who looks to come in? I have indicated. No. Okay.
I don't think so, Pat. Carry on.
Thank you. I appreciate that, and thank you for those answers. What would an independent review look like? Like, what would be the key elements of that to make sure that it was independent? Maybe start with Jason and then that's it.
I think that's something that should be, you know, discussed. I think that, you know, whether it's an independent panel review that kind of, you know, obviously takes into account how complex and varied the sector is. I mean, that's something that can be looked at. I mean, I think at this stage, our first priority is to really kind of stress the need for it to be independent, and then hopefully we can then have the discussion about what that specifically looks like going forward.
Thank you. On the point of independent review, it kind of related earlier on, you mentioned that the proposals before us are based on sort of Oscar's perceptions. Do these proposals, are they kind of skewed in that direction?
I think the proposals themselves, I mean, we broadly support the proposals. There's nothing in there that I think that we vehemently disagree with or think shouldn't be in there. I think perhaps some of the detail and information that's in there is perhaps skewed in the regulator's direction, and by which I mean that there isn't a great deal of information for the sector to kind of grapple with and really understand how that's going to work. So I think maybe not so much in terms of the proposals themselves. I mean, we completely understand that this particular bill seeks to give the regulator, you know, improvements and modifications that allow it to regulate better. So we understand that the regulator has to be at the heart of that. But I think in terms of information and how this is going to be implemented, I think there's a lot of questions that still exist in the sector. And I think that might be because this has been approached perhaps with not, you know, not taking that into consideration as much as could have been.
Thank you. Sarah, did you, when you spoke earlier, you said that there was aspects of the legislation that were missing, I think you'd said. Can you tell us a bit more about that?
Not so much that it's missing. We just don't feel like we feel like it could have gone further to address. There's a real challenge around trustee diversity. We feel that it could have gone slightly further. I mean, we do acknowledge that there's the dispensation scheme, which would allow for trustees who have, if there's sort of safety concerns, for to have their name removed from the record or not added to the record. And there's also the waiver scheme for example, for trustees, people who want to be trustees who've maybe would be disqualified. But the information around that waiver scheme's very light, and we don't really know how that would look. And we do feel that the default sort of disqualification would create issues for a lot of people from more marginalised groups. So it's not so much that the legislation has anything missing per se. I'd agree with Jason. There's nothing in there that we vehemently disagree with. It's more just the fact that it's quite light on detail, and we don't yet know. Some colleagues in the room from the faith community have acknowledged in their responses about the fact that trustees are volunteers and their time is for some of to be trustees is limited. So we would just need to make sure that the administrative burden isn't increased as a result of the legislation. And I don't think the information's readily available yet to understand if there would be an administrative burden for volunteers at this time.
Thank you, I appreciate that. I think my colleagues will possibly press some questions in that particular area later. I have nothing further at this point. Thank you.
Thanks, Pam. OK, we'll move on to theme two and questions from Paul McLennan.
Yeah, thanks, Camilla, and good morning, panel. The first question I was going to ask was talking around about the general principles of the bill and whether the existing charity law needs updated, and kind of hearing, obviously, from yourselves that it does. But I want to move on and look at all around about transparency and accountability. In the sector, we had our event yesterday, as the convener had said, and that kind of came through quite strongly. I just wonder if you have any views or thoughts on that at the moment, and I'll probably come to yourself, Jason, first of all, and in terms of that, around about transparency and accountability.
Yeah, I mean, SCVO absolutely supports the need for transparency and accountability. I think that we are pro-regulation where it's needed. So that is absolutely something we support. We support the aims and objectives of the bill. And more to the point, I think that across the bill, I think the proposals, although we do have the concerns around communication and how it's actually going to be implemented, I think the actual aims of increasing transparency and accountability, they are met by a number of the proposals in this bill. So certainly in terms of the actual aims that I think we all are kind of striving for with this bill, I think we absolutely agree with the need to go ahead with that, and we do see this bill as something that will work towards that.
Okay. Sarah?
Yeah, absolutely. Pretty much the same, to be honest. Yeah, I think that this bill does address the fact that there have been concerns about transparency and accountability within charities for a while now. So, and I think as well, it's transparency and accountability, but without being too onerous as well. So there's a good balance within the bill to addressing those concerns.
So just on that, is there any specific issues that you mentioned about the transparency and accountability, anything specifically?
From a volunteer perspective, I think just recognising that the ultimate governance of a charity is with the trustees, it lies with the trustees. They are accountable for what happens within charities. So making sure that it's much more clear who it is that's leading charities, and that is publicly available in the vast majority of cases, will make it much more transparent, and it will increase accountability.
Thanks, Sarah. I don't know if David Madeline wants to come in from a faith point of view. I know it was kind of raised yesterday when Ed Things was talking about names of trustees and whatever appearing more openly. I don't know if you have any thoughts, or David, maybe yourself first of all on that one, in terms of that.
Church councils of each church, and they are automatically the trustees for the local church property. So we understand the necessity for trustees to be transparent and it to be understood who the trustees are. So we are quite comfortable with the proposals that are being made for the transparency and accountability and the details of trustees that would be entered for names. Yes, we would be broadly supportive of the proposals.
Thanks, David. Madeline?
Yeah, we have had some concerns raised from some of our local trustees in a kind of general way, where people don't like to have their personal information shared. So it's good to see that it's only going to be names that are identifiable from the public register and not people's more personal data. And broadly, we support the fact that it does make charities in general more transparent and accountable.
Okay. Thank you for that. I kind of want to move on now to the role of OSCA and your views on the role of OSCA. And there's a couple of questions. One, the proposed extensions to OSCA's powers, are they appropriate and proportionate And secondly, does it operate effectively at the moment? And one of the key things that Kenny came through yesterday when we had a discussion was around about the capacity that Oscar would need to try and take on additional powers. So I get, Stephen, I'll maybe come to yourself first of all on that one, what your thoughts are in that regard, and then open it up beyond that. But Stephen, just yourself first of all.
Thank you. I guess from the Council's, our main interest in this is in terms of those charitable trusts where there's a mix of councillor trustees and trustees who are not councillors, and where we provide administrative support to those trusts. And it's appreciated the aim here is for a proportionate regime which will be effective. I guess our point is around whether it could perhaps be made a bit more proportionate with regard to very small charitable trusts. And in terms of Oscar's powers and the new provisions, I suppose the one that jumps out to us is the requirement to provide ongoing, throughout the year, notification of changes in terms of information to Oscar, which would appear in the schedule that they keep themselves, which wouldn't be public, but they would keep it themselves. And from our perspective, it's just the extra administrative work that would be required in that regard. And, could the provisions be made more proportionate by having some kind of financial threshold in place?
Okay, Stephen, thank you for that. Sarah, just the same question about Oscar's, does it operate effectively? And obviously, the new powers proportionate?
I think you're right to pick up on the fact that there will be an increase in capacity required to do some of what's been proposed. And one thing in particular, I think that we have some questions around is the appointment of interim charity trustees and the fact that will then fall to Oscar. And we have some questions about what the process would be for that, and because that's quite a significant undertaking, especially in the current climate where we know that, trustees are a bit like gold dust, so recruiting trustees can be a challenge for organisations. So how would Oscar propose to do that, and what capacity would be required? So that's just one example where I think it's still just a little bit light on the detail about how Oscar would actually undertake some of the duties that are proposed.
Firstly, I'd absolutely echo Sarah's points around that particular aspect of the bill. I think there is still a lot of detail there that needs to kind of, there's a lot of gaps that need filled in. We don't know what kind of approach would be taken in terms of recruiting an interim trustee. I think, as Sarah says, I think in Oscar's Scottish Charity Survey last year, it was 25% of charities in Scotland have said that recruiting trustees is a difficulty. So if a quarter of, around 25,000 charities in Scotland are finding a difficulty with recruiting trustees, I think that in the search for transparency and accountability, we need to make sure that we're not also compounding some of the struggles that the charities are already facing. In terms of another part of the bill that I think obviously gives Oscar a little bit more power, the power to issue positive directions, it's a part of the bill that, again, we understand and we support in principle, but again, there's that lack of detail. I know that within in the policy memorandum, it states that the list or the situations that a positive direction could be used cannot be exhaustively defined. But I think that the sector will still need some sort of idea as to when they could be used and in what circumstances. Again, it's that lack of communication, and I would hope that if we don't get that communicate or that detail through this process, at least post legislation, there would be a lot of burden. Again, it kind of draws into that question around the burden on Oscar. I think it's not just the burden in terms of administration and in terms of the ability to deal with the administrative burden that these additional powers would give. I think it's also about the engagement that's quite extensive that's going to be required after this. It's not just about putting comms out on the website. It will be about providing proper guidance and support, making sure that the length and breadth of the sector is aware of these changes, and ensuring that charities know the expectations that fall upon them, know about the dispensation mechanisms that are available to them, how those work. So I think it's both in terms of the administrative burden, but also the burden that will come with the sheer amount of comms that I think we would expect from the regulator after this.
So I suppose communications issues is vital, and particularly in regard to the smaller charities and so on. I was just going to go, kind of move on from that. The other one, probably yourself, Madeline. Obviously, the Church of Scotland's going through church closures and mergers and so on. And one of the issues, again, that was raised yesterday was talking about mergers, for example, and about what that would look like in terms of trustees and whatever. I don't know if you have any thoughts, obviously, on the role of Oscar, your experience and possibly what the Church is going through at the moment, and obviously, you know, whether you think Oscar's powers are proportionate at this stage.
So, as you say, the Church is going through a huge adjustment process at the moment with lots of congregations forming unions to try to reduce the number of ministers. But since 2005, when the Act came into force, the Church of Scotland had a lot of dialogue with Oscar about how unions of congregations within the Church of Scotland would be treated. And so if we have two congregations or three congregations who unite in terms of church law and charity law, whilst only one charity will remain on the register, the congregations continue to, they subsist within the union. So we've never had a problem with losing out on legacies in those circumstances. So that's not a problem that we had identified as being as needing to be resolved on behalf of the Church of Scotland. In terms of the bill being appropriate and proportionate, we do think that it is. And the only thing that we've tried to draw attention to is that there hasn't really been any joined up thinking with regard to the dual reporting that charities who are not registered as SCIOs are going to be subject to, in terms of A, having to put all the information in the charity register, and B, also having to submit that information to the RCI.
Madeline, thanks for that. I don't know if anybody else wants to come in at all. That's not that to me, convener.
In the interest of time, Paul, I think we'll need to move on to the next theme. So we will move on to information about charity trustees, and I'll bring in my colleague Evelyn Tweed.
Thanks, convener, and good morning, panel. Those with lived experience are an asset to boards and voluntary organisations. Do you anticipate that their details being published or having to ask for a waiver may put them off? And I would like to ask Sarah first.
In short, yes. It would be quite a significant barrier. So currently, I should caveat that by saying we do welcome the dispensation scheme, and it does go some way to reassure those potential charity trustees with lived experience who might experience some concerns about becoming a trustee if it meant that their personal details were made public. But we do still feel like the process is quite onerous. It's also not a particularly transparent process. There's not an awful lot of detail yet about the dispensation, but certainly the existing waiver scheme for disqualification is not particularly transparent in terms of the criteria. So from that perspective, we do have concerns. I mean, just to give you a bit of an idea, so we don't have a lot of information about the makeup of charity trustees in Scotland, but from the Charities Commission in England and Wales, we know that 75% of charity trustees are above a median income, 51% are retired, and 92% of trustees are white. So there is almost certainly a real challenge in terms of trustee diversity. And ideally, we'd be wanting trustees of the charities that are working for us to reflect the communities that they serve. And I think that will be particularly challenging given some of the existing barriers that, I mean, it's a difficult one because you've got to balance off the sort of the accountability that's required, recognising that being a charity trustee is a significant responsibility, but at the same time, you want to make it as easy as possible for people from currently underrepresented groups to get involved if they can.
Does anyone else want to?
I can see that David would like to come in online.
I think on this point, it's one thing to give the names of the charity, of the trustees. It is quite a different thing to give their private addresses. And I'm very pleased that the policy that seems to be adopted is not to have private addresses publicly shown on a public register. And this is where, to take up Madeline's point that she made about the RCI regulations, we have the absolute horror, to be honest, that private individuals, members of our church councils, who are just normal members of our church councils, they will automatically be our trustees. Their private names and addresses are going to be on a public register under the RCI regulations. And I think that is completely disproportionate, and it is counter to what has just been spoken about in the presentation of this bill. And I think it's really dangerous. And I think I don't understand how it got through with the RCI regulations when they were before the Parliament. But it's quite inappropriate for trustees, private individuals, for their addresses to be put into a public space. It's not as if the churches, and I'll speak for my church, it's not as if our church hides behind anything. If anybody wants to know a church property, there is plenty of information that's available as to who to speak to about anything to do with that church property. But it is quite inappropriate for private details, personal addresses of trustees to be put into the public domain. So so the exemption which has been applied to SCIOs should also be applied to all charities, because as a result of these changes that you are proposing, all charities will be in exactly the same position as SCIOs. So there is no logic for not extending that exemption to all charities which you currently have for SCIOs.
Could I also ask that there seems to be a concern about the proposal's diversity and how we make sure diversity is incoming with fresh blood. How can the proposals be strengthened to ensure that diversity is paramount? And maybe to Jason first.
I think again this touches firstly upon the communication around it. I think that, again, to touch on Sarah's point earlier, if we accept that there are dispensation mechanisms and there are processes for waivers of disqualification, etc., then firstly we need to make sure that those are proportionate and those are not putting off individuals who, again, as Sarah says, are perhaps from marginalised areas of the community or from different backgrounds. So I think we need to firstly get the mechanisms right, and we need to make sure that the decision making is correct, so the decision making takes those kind of points into mind when those decisions are being made. But again, I think it's about the optics of it. I think it's about the communication. We are talking about, you know, potentially very, very small charities of, you know, a handful of volunteers. They need to know that firstly the dispensation mechanism is not going to be, for example, intrusive or complex. They need to know that these processes are going to reach the correct decision. And so anybody from any background or any, you know, from a marginalised community also needs to know that when they put themselves forward, be it for to, you know, become a trustee or anything else with a charity, they need to know that they aren't going to face some sort of uphill battle or, you know, they're going to be discriminated against. So I think that it's about getting the mechanisms that are in the bill correct, but it's then about making sure that people understand that they're correct and understand that it's worthwhile and it's not intrusive and it's a fairly straightforward procedure and that the correct decisions will be made at the end of it.
Thank you, Evelyn. We'll move on to questions from Faisal Chowdhury, who is joining us online this morning.
Thank you, convener, and good morning, panel. I just have a small question. I mean, do the panel believe that during the consultation time, third sector organisations or ethnic minority organisations were involved? Just a general question, whoever wants to pick it up on. And Convener, I think the other question I wanted to ask, my colleagues have already asked, and I've got the answer.
Okay, thank you. Thanks, Faisal. So do you have any specific person you would like to direct that question to?
Not really, but anyone from the panel can choose that, because mine is general. I just want to know if if third sector organisations, smaller organisations, has been consulted or not.
Okay, we'll move to Sarah first, and then if anybody else would like to come in, please let me know.
Sure. I wasn't involved in the process, but just having I think that it was good that there was such a range of organisations, and the fact that quite a number of intermediaries were involved, and Jason will probably touch on that a lot better than I will. The fact that ACOSVO were involved is reassuring to us, because they have a network for trustees, so it recognises that trustees were involved. I think one thing that was struck me when I was reading about who was engaged in the process is the sort of relatively small numbers of organisations that were consulted within events, and the fact that it was only 12 TSIs out of a possible 32. So it could have gone further, but we were fairly satisfied that a range of voluntary organisations were involved. I think your point, though, about faith communities, given the quite significant, and minority ethnic communities as well, given the particular challenges that they might have experience as a result of this bill, maybe some further consultation with those particular groups might have been good.
Thank you, Sarah. Faisal, would you like to bring anyone else in, or are you quite content with that?
I'm quite content with that, but I mean, it is concerning, because quite a few of other colleagues are saying that in majority of the organisations you don't find it's balanced. But this is why I thought that consultation should have been more wider. Thank you very much, Convener.
Thank you. Thank you, Faisal. Just before we move on to the next theme, I just want to ask something that hasn't been covered. Do witnesses have any concerns around the proposal to publish unredacted accounts for all charities, regardless of size? And do you feel that the publication of accounts for all charities will enhance transparency and accountability within the charity sector? I'll move to Jason first, and then I'll maybe move to anyone online if they wish to come in, if you could let me know.
I think, again, I don't want to sound like a broken record, but I think, again, this focuses for us primarily on the processes around sort of dispensation mechanisms, etc. I think in terms of the publishing of the accounts themselves, I think we would support it, and I think that we would see it as being quite an important part of this bill in terms of achieving the aims of increasing transparency and accountability. Again, though, I think if there's information in there that should be redacted or removed, I think that as long as we are, or as long as the sector is confident that the mechanisms that are in place to reach that decision, the dispensation mechanisms, etc., they will play a really important role. I think that kind of underpins most of this bill. I think that there are proposals there that will achieve the objectives, but in order to keep the sector confident and secure, that they themselves can feel assured by this bill, I think that the dispensation mechanisms are really, really important. I think this is another example of that. So no great concerns at the overall part of the bill in terms of publishing accounts. We support that. We think it will increase transparency and accountability. But again, it's about getting it right, and it's about making sure the processes are there, that dispensation is awarded where it needs to be.
Thank you, Jason. Just kind of following on from that, would witnesses agree that removing charitable status from organisations that fail to submit accounts is an appropriate measure? Now, I know there were some views or mixed views around this in the informal session yesterday for a variety of different reasons. I'll look online to... Could I maybe bring David in for this one, please?
I think we would broadly support that. However, I would make a plea that... for example, where you have a charity which is a parent charity, for example, all of our church councils are individual charities, and the Methodist Church is the parent charity. So if a particular church was not doing what it should be doing, if notice could be given to the parent charity at the same time as notice is given to the individual charity, so that the centre understands that there's an issue which may have it may not be aware of, and it can then seek to address it.
Thanks, David. That's very helpful. If I have no one else looking to come in on those points, I will move on to our next theme and our Deputy Convener, Emma Roddick.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, everyone. I think I would like to direct this towards Sarah, because I know that Volunteer Scotland has talked about this in the past. Would you agree that it's sensible to have the same disqualification criteria here as in the rest of the UK?
I don't think we should have the same disqualification criteria just for the sake of being the same as the rest of the UK. I think, if anything, we've actually got an opportunity, and I don't know if this bill is the right place to look at that, but maybe when we're looking at a wider review of charity law, I feel like there's an opportunity for legislation in Scotland to go further. We certainly, in terms of the disqualification, the fact that the criteria for automatic disqualification, we feel like it might be a bit too punitive, particularly around bankruptcy. This is, in some ways, it's almost like it's criminalising poverty, which is particularly given where we're at the moment in terms of the cost of living crisis. I've actually got some figures around that. So at the moment in Scotland, this is from the Joseph Rowntree Foundation, we've got 160,000 households that are in debt, which is five times their monthly income. So just recognising how widespread debt is, and the fact that going down the route of bankruptcy is sometimes the only option for a lot of people who experience poverty. And it's worth recognising as well that lower income households are far more likely to be in debt. It feels unfair that would be a barrier for people automatically to become a trustee, particularly given the number of charities that we have within Scotland that are supporting people experiencing poverty. So there's a direct challenge there in terms of having trustees with lived experience on boards where poverty is one of the key focus. So with that point in mind, I feel like there's no need for us just to be in line with the rest of the UK. We could actually go further and have a much more inclusive approach to disqualification.
Thank you. And I'm glad to hear the specific reference to lived experience there, because I was going to specifically ask if there are sectors that recruiting lived experience would be made more difficult by the extension of the disqualification criteria. But in terms of the specific proposal as well to extend that disqualification to those in senior management positions, do you see there being specific recruitment challenges because of that?
Potentially. I mean, obviously, I'm from Volunteer Scotland, so I'm looking at this more specifically from a trustee perspective. But just speaking from experience in terms of there are moves, increasing moves within the voluntary sector to have all positions within organisations to be more representative and reflective of communities. So in the same way that it might be a barrier for trustees, it could equally be a barrier for people who are wanting to move into senior positions in organisations as well.
Okay, and just finally, do you think it is appropriate for OSCR to maintain a publicly searchable record of trustees who've been disqualified?
That's a good question. I think there are, in terms of the aims around transparency and accountability, I can understand why that would exist. And it almost needs to exist because of the requirements around disqualification. So it's a bit of a kind of double-edged sword at the moment. But if you challenge the criteria around disqualification, then having that publicly searchable record instantly, I don't know if that would necessarily be required anymore. But in terms of reducing the administrative burden and ensuring that organisations don't struggle to recruit trustees because they can't find information about whether or not they would actually be able to be a trustee, I think it's important that it exists to support the existing legislation. I hope that made sense.
Thank you.
Thanks, Emma. We have a supplementary from Pam.
Thank you, Convener. Just on that last point, is there a mechanism that could be used that was kind of somewhere in the middle, so it wasn't quite people are disqualified and the world and a granny can find the register of it, and reducing the burden of charities to have to find that? Like, could there be a register where they could contact OSCR and ultimately ask OSCR to say this person doesn't appear on this list? Basically, That was my first point. And then my second one was, in terms of the disqualification, I too was concerned about that, particularly given the impact that some charities can have on people wanting to rebuild their life, and part of that can be becoming a trustee. Is there... What would a kind of compromised, sort of wavered position look like from your point of view? Like how... Because I think we probably accept there needs to be some check and balance in those areas. How, what would an easy waiver look like, basically?
I think the fact that it's automatic disqualification, it's sort of the default, it's a kind of default no. If it was maybe more of a... if part of an application process. I'm not sure, to be honest. But I think having something where it was people were able to become a trustee in a particular area, because I'm just recognising actually that boards have got different positions. So things like maybe having it as a disqualification for people if they're going to be the treasurer, for example, might be an obvious first step. But to be honest, I'd like to take more time to sort of have a bit of a think about it. It's not something I've got any particular answers in my head right now. But I do just think that the current situation is maybe it goes too far in the wrong direction.
Jason, do you have anything to...
No, I think it would just... Yeah, I think we'd certainly agree with Sarah's points there. I think it's the idea of it being a default no. I think if you're talking about someone seeking to rebuild their lives, I think, again, it comes back to almost the optics of it. If you are automatically disqualified, that can give the impression that you kind of face some sort of uphill battle to try and prove that you are worthy to be a trustee. And I think so, as much as a similar position, don't have an instant answer in terms of what that process would look like. But again, I think it's about finding something that isn't, putting people off from the very beginning, because I think it would be very easy to, entertain the idea of becoming a trustee, find out that you're automatically disqualified because of something that's occurred in your background, and, just decide that it's not worth the hassle, essentially. And I think that's something that we really need to try and avoid.
Thank you.
Thank you, Pam. We'll now move on to questions from Miles Briggs.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning to the panel. Thank you for joining us today. I want to ask a number of questions with regards to inquiries which OSSA can make, and whether or not the panel believe that the powers should be extended to allow OSSA to undertake inquiries into former charities and their trustees as well. Maybe bring yourself in, Sarah, and if anyone online wants to come in.
I don't think that there's necessarily any concerns around that. I think in terms of again, that kind of accountability, and what kind of immediately springs to mind is if you're thinking about child safeguarding as an example, where there's maybe an inquiry further down the line and there's a need to look at an organisation that no longer exists, and it makes sense to be able to see who was responsible for that charity historically. So from that perspective, I don't think there's a challenge, but obviously the same dispensation would need to be in place for those individuals where it could be a kind of safety concern.
Yeah. Does anyone else have anything they want to add on that? No. If not, I'll move on to... My other question was with regards to OSCA being able to issue positive directions following their inquiry work. And to also add to that, the question over whether or not it's appropriate for designated religious charities to be exempt from this provision going forward as well. I'll maybe bring in yourself, Madeline, on that point. And anyone else who wants to add anything, please, can you?
So our position is that we do think it's appropriate for a DRC to be the people who are exempt from these provisions, because we feel that our internal structures are, and OSCA are satisfied that our internal structures are such that we have appropriate supervisory and an acceptable degree of self-regulation and disciplinary procedures in place. We also feel that we are better placed to act in a disciplinary function. We have, in terms of our church acts, we've probably got more powers than OSCA does. So we can take disciplinary action against trustees in these circumstances where we feel it is required. And it obviously has to be recognised that the legitimate autonomy of the church has been recognised in matters of worship, doctrine, government and discipline. And that's an important point that has to be made.
Thank you. David, do you want to come in on this point as well?
Well, the Methodist Church in Scotland is not a designated religious charity, but we have our own, very like the Church of Scotland, we have our own legislation, Acts of Parliament and subordinate legislation, which governs our discipline and procedures. So we have a very robust system in place. But again, I would actually ask here that if there is an issue that Oscar is wanting to take up with a charity, which might lead to a positive direction, that the parent charity should be advised. Because if the parent charity is advised in the Methodist Church, then quite frankly, the Star Chamber will get active.
Thank you. Anyone else have any points on that? I wanted to move on to the issue of connection to Scotland, which has also emerged and introduced in the bill as a requirement, and to ask specifically whether or not the panel believe that charities should be in this position to have to demonstrate a connection to Scotland, and whether or not that's an appropriate measure. Jason, do you have anything you want to?
Yeah, I mean, SCVO's position from the beginning has been consistently in support with this particular part of the bill. We understand the reasoning behind it. We're entirely supportive of it. I think our original... This is one area where I think there has been clarification provided and it has been slightly reframed, taking on board some of the feedback through the consultation. I think that the original consultation, particularly in 2019, there was a great deal missing in terms of clarity around what was actually meant by a connection with Scotland. I think that the bill provides that clarity, and I think that what it does is it kind of reframes it slightly. So it kind of now reframes the question as, you know, the idea of which charities is it not appropriate for Oscar to regulate rather than the ones it should. And I think that reframing of it just adds a little bit of clarity there as well. So we support it, and we don't have any great issues.
That's helpful. Thank you. Does anyone else have anything contrary to that they want to add? No. If not, I'll move on to my final questions, and we've touched on this already, with regards to powers to appoint interim trustees in specific circumstances where there's no trustees. And wanted to ask how in practice you think that could work. You've already said it's difficult enough to find people sometimes, but how in practice do you think that might present challenges of who these interim trustees would then be? I don't know, Sarah.
I think the obvious challenge is the fact that it's quite a difficult place out there in terms of recruiting trustees. But I think as well, it's thinking about the diversity that we've got within our sort of charitable sector in Scotland and the size and scale of the organisations. Like often, if we think about how trustees are normally appointed, it's usually done by the organisation or representatives within the organisation who have an understanding of the needs of that charity, the clientele of that charity. I'm a bit confused about how Oscar would be able to appoint people with the kind of local knowledge and the knowledge of the client group. So I think it would be quite a challenge, to be honest. But this is an area where there isn't a huge amount of information at present. It's definitely an area where we have some concern.
Yeah. Does anyone else have anything to add to that?
Sure. Quickly come in and kind of highlight again, I think this bill is kind of underpinned by a lot of proposals that have safeguard measures, and this is one area that noticeably doesn't, what that would look like, whether it would be a mechanism for charities to, you know, ask for it to be reviewed in terms, I'm not sure, but it is noticeable that this is one area of the bill that doesn't have a safeguard in place.
Yeah, and whether or not it's a sort of emergency measure more than anything, but we'll hopefully look more into that. And then just finally, in terms of a finance question with regards to charities merging, and I declare an interest, I chair Heart of Scotland appeal in Scotland around this, whether or not you think this makes it easier for legacy charities and resources to be transferred in these situations, and anything you want to add on that, where maybe a charity has merged or changed its name, for example?
I think SCVO's position on this particular proposal is to support it. I think it will, certainly from what we've heard from some of the organisations that we've spoken to in the build-up to this, has been wide support. So I think we are quite content with that part of the bill.
Good. That's all my questions. Thank you. Thanks, Convener.
Thanks very much, Miles. And I will move lastly to Jeremy Balfour.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning. Can I just... for public declare, I am a member for Church of Scotland and I'm also a trustee of a number of different charities of different sizes. I wonder if I can go back, Jason, because I have to say, not that clever, so I'm sure you will be able to help me here. But I don't understand what a connection to Scotland means legally. Can you help me out in regard to what that actually means legally? Because you said it's a good thing, and I understand that. But within legal definitions, what does it actually mean legally?
In terms of, obviously, I'm not a lawyer, so I can't go too into the details in terms of legal. In terms of this, in terms of the regulator in OSCAR, I think that there are specific points now that we can look at. I think that the bill itself contains the specific aspects that the regulator would be looking towards in terms of that connection. I think we are content that the aspects that the aspects that are set out in the bill, I think we are content that it won't exclude, for example, charities that are cross-border charities. We don't think it will exclude, for example, charities that are based in Scotland but work for the benefit, of communities out with Scotland. So I think the bill, does clarify what that connection will look like. And as I said earlier, I think that it's also been reframed in quite a good way, that it's more about, identifying the small number of charities that perhaps OSCAR shouldn't be regulating, rather than seeking to deprive any organisations of being regulated.
So you're happy with it? You think there's enough there for definition?
At this stage, yeah. I mean, it may be something that, if there was to be post-legislative scrutiny, it could be something that could be looked at in the future, but certainly on the basis of what's in the bill, yeah, we would be okay with that. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you. If I can move on, just two final questions for me. Firstly, are you concerned there's going to be additional costs for charities because of these regulations, and particularly smaller charities who don't have full-time staff? So if you're a kind of small charity, is this going to be more expensive for them and also more time consuming? Maybe start again with you, Jason.
Yeah, no. I think again, it kind of touches on the earlier points around the lack of real concrete detail around implementation. But I would suggest that there is certainly the potential for that. I think with regards to even, a lot of the processes, we don't know yet whether there's going to be, digital solutions with regards to that. But, so there's so much of the process itself that we don't know about. But certainly there is the potential that there could be additional costs, additional administrative burden, and there is the potential that could disproportionately impact smaller charities. And I think that's where the comms and the actual processes and the detail comes in.
Stephen, I wonder if I can bring you on this, because obviously this will affect local authorities as well. Are you concerned about extra costs that you will face?
Yes, and it comes back to the requirement throughout the year, as I said earlier, to keeping OSCAR up to date on changes to details kept in their schedule. Now, I suppose a lot would depend on questions which OSCAR are going to publish, which will indicate what information they're going to want to hold. But it's a task, clearly, that would need to be kept on top of throughout the year. And so, inevitably, there would be extra administration involved. And I think that's really why I mentioned earlier the possibility of having some kind of financial threshold for smaller charities. If a charity fell below that threshold, perhaps it wouldn't require to provide all those details for OSCAR's schedule on an ongoing basis. But yes, it's to do with the ongoing administration throughout the year, which may not be so proportionate for a small charity with, say, a small annual income.
That's all right. Maybe just back to Sarah and Jason on this, because you're obviously dealing with smaller charities. Do you think there should be, as Stephen has suggested, some kind of financial target, but if you don't have X amount of expenditure or turnover a year, you have to do less than, say, the National Trust or the Church of Scotland have to do?
I mean, it's certainly a possibility. I mean, I'm just thinking about the range of charities that exist. I mean, you've got the sort of the big ones that you've just mentioned, but you also have, you know, small town hall committees that maybe only have less than £1,000 in the bank. So it could be a possibility, yeah. But I think I would very much agree with what Jason said, that we don't know yet what the financial burden or the administrative burden is likely to be, because we don't have that clarity yet around the process. So it's quite difficult to make a sort of definitive statement on this without knowing that detail.
Thank you. My final question is a kind of throwaway question, but actually maybe quite important, and maybe just go around the whole panel. Marij, if you could add one thing to the bill that's not in it, what would it be? And if you don't want to answer right now, you can maybe write to us. I appreciate it. I've just asked you to think of a stop. But, you know, we've talked about what's in the bill. I think we're all pretty comfortable with maybe some modification. But is there something when you think, if only that was in, that would make the life of a volunteer or a trustee easier?
I think for me, it would be all about the waiver around disqualification. That for me is the biggest potential barrier to diversity on boards. So removing the automatic disqualification, I'm not suggesting that this necessarily needs to be within this bill, but certainly at a future review of charity legislation, that to me is the biggest thing.
I'll go to Jason and then go on to those online if they've got any question, any thought.
At the risk of sounding like I'm just stealing Sarah's answer, it would be similar. I think that was certainly the one thing that jumped out at us and those that we spoke to. I think it's really important to get that particular aspect right, and I think something that gave us the assurance that was going to be adequate, I think would certainly be something that we would change.
Can I go to those online? Do you have any one thing that you would love to see within the bill? Or are you happy?
I'll bring Madeline in first, thank you.
Yes, so we are disappointed that the bill does not extend to allow OSCR to approve reorganisation of charities which have been established under Royal Charter, Warrant or Enactment. This means that they have to go to the Court of Session to make changes, which is a very cumbersome, time-consuming and expensive process.
Would anyone else online like to come in on that?
No, I'm done. Thank you.
We're good. Okay. Thank you very much, everyone, for your evidence this morning and for coming along. I will just briefly suspend to allow our witnesses to change over. Thanks again.
Welcome back, everyone. Welcome to the meeting, our second panel. So we have Vicky Cahill, Policy Officer, Alzheimer's Scotland, Riddle Wadhwa, Chief Executive Officer, Edinburgh Rape Crisis Centre, Ramil Kasha, Chief Executive, Children's Hospices across Scotland, who all join us in person, hello, and Shona McLennan, Chief Executive Officer, Bordna Gaelic, who is joining us remotely. As with the first panel, a few points to mention about the format of the meeting, and apologies in advance for this. Please wait until I or the member asking the question say your name before speaking. Please allow our broadcasting colleagues just a few seconds to turn your microphone on before you begin to speak. You can indicate with an R in the dialogue box in blue jeans or simply with a show of your hand if you wish to come in and a question. And again, please don't feel you all have to answer every question. If you've nothing to add to what's been said by others, it's absolutely fine. Before we begin, I would just like to start by putting on the record that Bordna Gaelic requested that they give their evidence in Gaelic this morning. Clerks have spoken with colleagues across the Parliament with a view to facilitating interpretation of this evidence session. However, we have been informed that this was not possible due to various factors. The Parliament is aware that there is an issue and are acting to resolve it as new broadcasting systems come into operation, and we are truly sorry for not being able to facilitate interpretation at our meeting on this occasion and recognise that this is an unfortunate situation. I will now pass over to Deputy Convener Emma Roddick, who in Gaelic will invite Bordna Gaelic to give a short introduction to their evidence in Gaelic, and afterwards they will provide an interpretation in English before we hear from witnesses. I'll pass over to Emma now.
Morin tying, Natalie, agus tying hana hula niach finish aha a gal parch anson session andu. Hami anish a hort curich do Bordna Gaelic rora. Gorich a hort sechet mis totic sheen. Shona.
Atlai. Matinda Harika is Boyle in the committee. She Udam Mahangosa Fianish a horse shachet is Le Koyers Nakin Gaelic and Jew. It's Bavalan Pang a horse gonna committee or son of Horam Shaw. As Silvia Gavilabur, Hooch Dagunyan and Alaba, Taichok in a Gaelic. Agus gabail fas an in yuzachid na Gaelic, an da chuch an in sculchin agus mesk enidich. An in lesanachid na Gaelic ha tor ir yanav le bunyan suur holoch a ha clarachta mar haranasan. Is mar sin ha uirik bord na Gaelic sa vila sio, leis gabail sin a gubber gudrich leis na bunyan sin. Ha mi kinsach gandur an committee curm a yunsach na yin caranasan a ha gubber sa Gaelic nur a ha hul na baul ur uish ur chen dikin herkenin an an co hexa I per yelishta. Good morning, Chair and members of the committee. It's an honour for me to give evidence to the committee today on behalf of Bordna Gaelic and on behalf of Gaelic speakers, and welcome the committee's recognition of the importance of Gaelic in Scotland. You may be aware that it is increasingly clear from the Scottish Social Attitudes Survey and other sources that the majority of people in Scotland are supportive of Gaelic, and also that there is a significant growth in learning Gaelic, both in formal education and amongst adults. Since 2019, some 1.5 million people have engaged with learning Gaelic through Duolingo, and about 400,000 are currently learning through Speak Gaelic. Bordna Gaelic's role is to promote and support development of the Gaelic language through developing a National Gaelic Language Plan, working with public authorities, and also in partnership with a wide range of community organisations. The last are particularly important for increasing opportunities for using Gaelic in social, sporting and cultural activities. So we recognise that for Gaelic, a significant amount of development work is delivered by volunteer groups, which are registered charities. And Bordna Gaelic work includes distributing funds to these organisations to support this development. And therefore, our role reflects the key role of charities as delivery partners. Since 2018-19, we have awarded 522 grants to 181 different charities. That's almost half of the total grants that we awarded, and the value of our grants during that time was also almost 13 million, which is more than 2/3 of all the grants we awarded. In terms of the information to be included in the Scottish Charity Register, we believe it would be useful to raise awareness of Gaelic and of organisations that undertake Gaelic activities if the Gaelic name of an organisation was recorded as well as an English one. And it would also raise the profiles of these organisations in the work that they do. We submitted more information in our answer to this consultation. I'm very happy to provide that as we go through the meeting. Maureen Thames.
Thank you very much, Shona. We'll now move straight on to questions from members, and I will move back to Pam Duncan-Glancy to start us off.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, and thank you for the evidence you've submitted in advance, and thanks for today and the questions you're about to answer. Kind of similar to what some of you will have heard who were in the room earlier, I'm keen to understand a bit about the consultation process that's led to the bill in front of us today, and how would you characterise your involvement in that? And I'll start with Rami, if that's okay.
Yes, of course. We haven't been particularly aware or involved in the consultation process. That said, it happened during lockdown, and my characterisation of these proposals is that they're relatively minor. So it would have been good to have been more involved, but I recognise that the circumstances were as they were. If there were going to be a wider reform of charity law, I think we as a charity would want to be more closely involved at an earlier stage.
Thank you. Do any of the other panel members want to come in? Do you want to? Vicky.
Thank you. Alzheimer's Scotland were initially involved in the consultation process back in 2019. However, the timing of the second part of the consultation coincided with the pandemic. And as an organisation, we had to refocus and redirect our resources, and our ability to participate in further consultation was interrupted by that. So in terms of the overall process, we feel as if it has been an interrupted process due to the timing of the consultation and the ability of not just ourselves but several other organisations to be able to participate and to join in that conversation. Having said that, we are keen to be involved and to participate in a future conversation around charity regulation.
Thank you. I appreciate that. Would you like to come in on from online? Or?
Thank you. As a public body, we scan what consultations are being published. So for us, it was normal part of the process, but we all operate differently to charities. I recognise that.
Appreciate that. Thank you. And the other area I wanted to explore at this point was around the review that's been mentioned. What do you think that needs to take into consideration? We've heard a little bit about the independence of that. What would it look like to panel members to be broad enough and to be independent? I might go backwards this time, so I might start with Vicky and then work back around the panel to online.
Thank you. So in terms of a wider review, we would absolutely welcome the opportunity to have a wider review of charity regulation. I think there's a need for a recognition of the changing landscape or that charities are currently operating in at the moment, the impact of the pandemic, the ongoing impact of the cost of living crisis, and how charities are operating within the environments that's setting up, those conditions that are around. The Act that we're looking at and that we're looking to change and make amendments to is in need of modernisation. It's been in existence since 2005 with very little in the way of change or amendment to it. And again, it isn't necessarily reflective of the current context. So we would certainly welcome the opportunity to have that wider review. Again, what that review would look like, I think, should be open to discussion, and it should welcome discussion from large parts of the sector and shouldn't solely be focused on the regulator's position or the position of large parts of the sector, but should be widened to make sure that as many charities have an opportunity to input and influence what it looks like in the overall context.
Thank you.
We would welcome a review, and I'd just like to echo what Vicky said. And I guess our sector is currently going through a strategic funding review, and which is an independent review. And I would say that what is refreshing about that process is that the The people conducting the review came to us and were very flexible in how and diverse in how they approached engagement with our sector. You know, just to reflect back on your earlier question, I would say that we were not involved till maybe 2 days before this consultation to the committee closed in submitting our response. So that says a lot about our capacity to engage. But if I'm reflecting back on the strategic funding review that we are going through within the violence against women sector, I would say the positives of that is that we were reached out to in many ways, and that's what we would welcome. So the question of minority organizations or marginalized groups or those working within marginalized groups being excluded from reviews will be better addressed.
Thank you.
Charities do amazing things in Scotland, so I think any review has got to start from what works really well rather than what doesn't. So thinking about it from that perspective might unlock how we can build on something that's really, really good. I think from the point of view of charity regulation, I would reflect as a charity that's providing health services, and we're regulated by Oscar Companies House, the Care Inspectorate, Healthcare Improvement Scotland. They all do really important things, but there are areas where they could be better coordinated and more streamlined. So any wider review should take into account, I think, how different aspects of regulation work for charities.
Just on that point, do you think there's a need to pull some of that together into one sort of regulatory framework, or do you think there's a need for each organisation to come to a kind of agreement between themselves but still do their own significant part?
I think it's working separately. I suppose I would reflect just a simple example about the names of trustees. If this proposal were to go through, then we would be providing the names of our trustees to four separate regulators four different times. So there's maybe an opportunity to think about how that can be streamlined. I think it's about working together rather than any major structural reform.
Okay.
And I should say there's no issue about providing names of trustees for us. It's just the administrative burden of doing that.
Yeah, I appreciate that. That makes sense. Thank you. And can I go online as well now, please?
Thank you. We very much welcome the opportunity to take part in a review, and particularly by, I think, coordinating with the charitable organisations that we fund. Many of them are very small, don't have paid employees. So if there was a way we could coordinate a response with them, that would be, I think, a very helpful way to support them giving their views into such a review.
Thank you, Shona. Thank you for that. Thank you to others for the question.
Thank you, Pam. We'll move now to questions from Paul McLennan.
Thanks, Convener. I just wanted to ask a few questions, obviously, around about the general principles of the bill. And I think a few of you probably heard the questions that were asked in the first panel. One was around about, do you agree that the existing charity law needs to be updated? And I'll probably come to yourself, Rami, and then open it up beyond that.
I mean, in a proportionate degree, there's nothing in the bill that is problematic or would be a bad thing to do, I think. So in that sense, the answer to your question is yes, because these are sensible, tidying up proposals that improve the regulation of charities. But they are quite focused, and they very much come from a point of view where regulation is the starting point. And actually, there might be other things around charity law that could be looked at in a wider review. But there's nothing controversial in this.
No, I don't know if there's anybody else got anything else to add differently to that, because I think we mentioned at the session we had yesterday tidying up was a phrase that was used quite a bit across that. In relation to transparency and accountability in the sector, are there any weaknesses that you can try and identify? Murdoch, I'll probably come to yourself in terms of that, or any comments on that, and then open it up beyond that.
Well, I suppose there are a number of factors there. One is around the proposal of disqualification of trustees, if that's your question. I think we would like to see a process that is transparent and clear, and that also does not exclude, as the previous respondent said earlier, from Volunteer Scotland, people with lived experience, and we would also want to be careful that bankruptcy does not automatically disqualify you from being a trustee or even a member of the senior management of a charity.
Thanks. Vicky, yourself?
So from an Alzheimer's Scotland point of view, we would be advocate for any measure that would increase accountability and transparency in terms of charity regulation. We would support every effort to increase the voice of lived experience. We think that that is a particular piece of important process that needs to be involved and included within any legislative framework around charity regulation, and actively encouraging the participation of the voice of lived experience to ensure that that creates transparency from the ground up rather than from a top-down perspective.
Shauna, any thoughts on that? And then I'll bring in Rami if there's any thoughts beyond that.
The only thing is, I think the very small organisations that we work with, that any processes shouldn't be overly burdensome on small organisations. So it's matching requirements with capacity to deliver, I think, would be the important thing from our perspective.
Anything else to add apart from what you've heard?
Just to reflect that transparency and accountability are really important for charities. The primary duty to be transparent lies with the trustees and should remain with the trustees. The role of the regulator should be to set the framework that allows trustees to provide that transparency in respect of their own charity. And that really goes to the last point about making sure that we recognise the wide range of charities and sizes of charities that will do things in different ways.
Thanks for that. I wanted to move on just to really talk around about the role of OSCAR and your thoughts on, does it operate effectively? And I suppose that we're then looking at the extensions to OSCAR's powers. Are they appropriate and proportionate? Rami, I'll probably come to yourself and open up beyond that.
Yes, I think broadly speaking, the proposed extensions are proportionate and appropriate. I think there will be quite a number of areas where OSCAR will need to provide detailed guidance about how it intends to use those powers through publication of its regulatory policies, so that there's transparency and understanding both between the regulator and charities about how these powers will work in practice. But broadly speaking, I think they are appropriate and will seek to use appropriately, will strengthen public trust in charities.
Shauna, any thoughts on your interactions with OSCAR?
We don't interact directly, but I would just echo what Rami said just now as well.
Wardle, Vicky, anything else to add?
Just to, our interaction as a reasonably sized charity in Edinburgh is pretty limited with OSCAR. It happens maybe once or twice a year. They respond well, but with increased powers, we would be interested to know what sort of capacity they will have for greater interaction with us, because I think these proposals might require us to have more interaction than normal.
A watch and brief, if you like, on how that would interaction continues. Vicky, just on yourself.
Yes, certainly. So just to echo similar sentiments as have already been expressed, but also about the importance of remembering that OSCAR has to provide a bit of a dual function. So it provides not only that disciplinary action, but it's also there to provide support and guidance to charities. And I think it's really important that any legislative framework is there and that both of those functions are performed, so particularly around the support and guidance. And that is equally where it's important that openness and transparency comes not only from the third sector towards OSCAR, but that it's reflected back the way, and that the openness and transparency starts from OSCAR and works its way down from there.
Thanks, Vicky. I think that's a good way to finish my question. Thanks, Convener.
Thanks very much, Paul. Now we move to questions from Evelyn Tweed.
Thanks, Convener, and good morning, panel. Some responses have requested that the data be kept to a minimum. What do you see as too much data? And I'm going to ask Vicky first, and if anybody else wants to come in, please do.
So Alzheimer's Scotland advocated in its response to the committee that OSCAR should only use the minimum amount of information necessary in order to be able to perform its function. So anything beyond the scope of that would be too excessive. We advocate the position that people who choose to take up the role of trustee within a charitable organisation still have the right to data protection. They still have the right to privacy enacted to them through existing law. So therefore, we would advocate that position. We believe that the publication of names only would be sufficient in terms of public offerings, in terms of making that information available to the wider system. But anything beyond that which would be held in an internal record should also be kept to a minimum, because we would like to satisfy and ensure that that information, we have to understand what information is being gathered, how it will be stored, and what mechanisms, if any, there will be in order to share that information either within OSCAR itself or beyond OSCAR. So it's really important that we're clear that we're taking on board the absolute minimum so that we can still ensure the privacy and the protection of individuals.
I think Rami did one in.
I was just going to reply around the publication of information. I mean, I'm reflecting on my own charity in Chas. We publish 100-page annual report every year with, you know, full accounts, full reporting on activity, lots of detail around charity governance, and made that publicly available. So, you know, whilst it's really important to maintain issues around confidential information and data protection, actually there's a huge amount that charities can and should be doing to describe their work, and I have no, you know, I'm entirely comfortable with doing that, and I think many other charities would be too.
Thank you.
The information goes, it should be very limited to names. I mean, we are, as a charity, registered with Companies House, so we use our official address because we have to declare an address for our directors, or also our trustees. But in recent times, there have been particular risks to trustees who have served on our charity, and so we would be quite cautious about what information of theirs is available outside or to the in the wider community. And we are also keen, as a, you know, I can speak for my charity, but I know about my sector, quite keen to bring in more diversity and people with lived experience. There are safety concerns for some who would join us as trustees, and any information that is held about them should be the bare minimum.
Okay. On that same theme, Murdo, we talked in the last panel about there being concerns about diversity, inclusivity, and the proposals and how we move forward with that. How do we strengthen the proposals to make sure that diversity and inclusivity are paramount?
I think, as to echo what Volunteer Scotland said, I think it's the process of what the bill proposes and how do you go about ensuring that any processes that around disqualification or inclusion in for those who want to work or volunteer at charities such as ours. This is a simple process. It does not create fear or reinforce fear of the state or state intervention. And I'm thinking particularly for people from certain marginalized communities, those who've been through the asylum process or even managed migration process, as well as trans people. We have good evidence of lived experience of experiencing state oppression. So anything where the state is now collecting information, because that's how they're likely to see it, must be simple and less intrusive and very, very respectful. I don't know what that would look like, but I think that should be at the center of any process that is developed.
Do you have any further questions, Emma?
No, that's you. Thank you. Perfect.
Thank you very much. We'll now move to questions from Faisal Chowdhury, who is joining us online.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Convener. My question probably to Mijula, and obviously I'll want Rami to come in as well. As you probably know, that I've been involved in third sector organisation all my life, and I've been working with smaller organizations and bigger organizations. And I've always found that smaller organizations find it very difficult to liaise with OSCAR or the company houses and big organizations. But my question to both of you, it will be, do you think that smaller organizations were involved during the consultation period, and ethnic minority organizations too, from the previous panel, the answer was there was only 12. But do you think that was enough?
In my first response, I did say that, you know, we got involved in this consultation like 2 days before it closed. My wild guess would be probably not, and having worked in minority ethnic organizations before and been on boards there, it's very unlikely that there would have been capacity or engagement, which is why any future review must factor in how those who are conducting the review should come to us rather than us coming and responding to consultations in the more traditional way.
Rami, do you want to comment? Yeah.
I think that's a really important point, and if there's going to be a wider review of charity law, important to make sure that lots of different voices, including a wide range of organisations representing a wide range of people, are involved in that, and there'll be an opportunity to do that, I hope.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Convener. Another small question to Rami. Do you think that the current charity law, is there anything you believe is out of date and the smaller organisations should know about?
That's a really hard question. I'm not sure I can answer it well. I'm a charity leader, but I'm not a lawyer, so I don't know that I can give that question much justice. But I suppose what I would say is that running a charity can be complex. There are a lot of requirements placed rightly on charity trustees and charities organisationally and staff. So anything that can be done to help people understand that what their obligations are is really important. And I would really commend the work of SCVO in relation to that. They, I think, do some excellent work in helping charities, particularly smaller charities, understand their responsibilities. But perhaps there's more work that Oscar could do too.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Convener. I don't have any other questions.
Thank you very much, Faisal. Or around the publication of charity accounts, I'd like to ask if witnesses have any concerns around the proposal to publish unredacted accounts for all charities, regardless of size, and whether you think that the publication of these accounts for all charities will enhance transparency and accountability within the charity sector. And if I could move to Shona online first, and then I'll bring some in from the room. Thank you.
Thank you, Convener. And I'll be honest, I don't have a view on that. We ask when organisations apply to us for funding, we ask for their accounts as part of the due diligence process. And as far as I'm aware, we don't see any risks in them publishing full accounts. But we don't deal with the full range of charities that there are in Scotland. So from our perspective, no, but that's not to say I don't think that applies across the board.
Thank you very much, Shona. And I guess just kind of following on from that then, from my original question, would you agree as well that removing the charitable status from organisations that fail to submit accounts is an appropriate measure? I'll perhaps go to Vicky first and then I'll bring the rest of you in.
So in terms of removing someone from the register because they've failed to submit and then publish accounts in accordance with the legislation, we feel that that's quite a draconian step, and actually in order to get to there, that should be the last possible step as part of a built-in process. I think it's important to ensure that Oscar provides reasonable support and guidance to enable charities to be able to meet the criteria and the obligations set out for them. And there has to be a recognition that there may be reasons as to why there would be failure to comply with a particular direction, particularly around the submission or publication of accounts. So, for example, there could be reasons around either capacity within the organisation itself or administrative issues around how that's done. There could also be conflict amongst existing trustees in terms of how things should be done, when they should be done, and so on. So I think it's important that Oscar has a role in terms of that support and guidance around how it supports that. And in the initial response that Alzheimer's Scotland made back at the beginning of the process around this, we recognised that there needed to be the ability to show a persistent failure to do so. So a desire to be able to do something is not the same as not being in a position to be able to do so. So I think that that support from OSCAR has to be imparted in terms of, you know, part of that process and that mechanism as to how that would actually work. And that's where more detail is required as to how that would be carried out.
Thank you. That certainly echoes some of the views we heard in the informal session yesterday. Vido or Rami, I'm not sure if either of you would like to come in on this, if you've got anything else to add on those points. Yes, Rami? Oh, I'll bring Rami in and then I'll bring Vido in. Thank you.
Yes, I mean, I think the answer to your question, convener, is yes, it would promote, and it does promote public confidence. I, as a charity, you are in a privileged position around the handling of money from donations from the public. You're in a privileged position around tax, gift aid. These are things where public accountability is important. So I do think the publication of accounts is something that is important and charities should do. There is a scale around what a set of accounts look like and the level of detail that needs to go into an annual report and accounts. But the principle of it, I think, is important and does and promote public confidence. I think the point about what the sanctions might be for not publishing accounts, I think, is a good point. And striking a charity off would surely be the very last thing that ought to be happening. But it doesn't seem in principle an unreasonable sanction to exist as long as it's used proportionately.
Thank you very much. You too.
I don't have anything to add on the second question, but on the first one, in our response, we said we believe it's a good thing to be able to publish and that charities should publish their accounts, but it should come with some support for those reading those accounts to understand what they mean, and also some support for charities where that information, if it is going to be used maliciously against them, for them to receive support from OSCAR, because that is a possibility if the accounts are not read accurately.
Thank you. Thank you very much. We'll now move on to questions from Deputy Convener Emma Roddick.
Thank you, Convener. I'm directing the first question towards Riddle, because I know that Rape Crisis Centre did submit some evidence on this already. Could she expand on the proposal to extend disqualification criteria to senior management positions and how this would affect recruitment?
So in the first panel spoke a little bit to that about who comes to work in charities and where people come from, and if we are disqualifying people based on bankruptcy as one example, then it can exclude a number of people whose pathway into charities like ours is not as those who've written this would expect. So people come through various challenges in their lives, particularly within our sector. So I think it presents some difficulties for us. The other questions we have is, what are the additional recruitment methods that we will need to use? We currently do use PVGs for all our roles within our organization. I don't actually know if PVG looks at bankruptcy and things like that. We just receive the information of who was excluded to work with. But I think we need to be careful about that disqualification. And also, if you're, it's the wording is phrased as, if you have control over money. But most charities have reasonable processes on how finances are handled. It never really is one person. It's not, the CEO is usually shared between trustees and senior management. So I think we need to be more careful. And if that is what comes, then I guess there are cost implications for charities and recruitment. And, if you look at our accounts, we look like we have a decent income, but most of that is for frontline service delivery. We often don't have much capacity in terms of core support staff and admin. So we need to be mindful of that. I'm sure there is a lot more to say, but this is where I'll stop my answer today.
Thank you very much. And I know most witnesses were listening to the earlier panel as well and may have heard me ask Sarah this. So I wonder if any have a view on whether it's sensible or necessary to have the same disqualification criteria here as in the rest of the UK.
I agree with Sarah.
I think there's an opportunity for us to have a look at what is available and what's there. There is a value to having a degree of consistency. However, if it's, we're looking at sharing of information cross-border, then I think it's also useful to have a clear set of guidelines around how information is shared and what information may be shared. So in the event, for example, that Scotland strengthens its position around disqualification and the information that it holds around that, and if that exceeds the level that exists cross-border, then we have to consider how understanding of what information would then be shared in comparison with our neighbours.
Thank you. And just finally on this theme, I'd like to go to Shona, because I'm keen that we pick up on geographical issues here, and I don't just mean, you know, distances and topography, but cultural as well. And I wonder if she has any insights on the impact of disqualifying criteria in terms of, you know, within Gaelic organisations and rural and island organisations, people having multiple roles and being relied on for lots of different roles.
I think one of the things that we see, particularly in island rural areas, and that's it's to do with the population, the demographic changes, is the decreasing number of people actually available to carry out trustee roles. And also in any small community, whatever that community is, the kind of the reputational risk around people, and so I think all of these things have to be handled extremely carefully. And at the same time, what we want is more people to participate, but we also have to make sure that there's a rigorous process that ensures that anybody in a position of authority in a charitable organisation has confidence about that. I didn't hear the part about the cross-border sharing, so I won't comment on that at all. But I recognise that there are challenges in small communities about participation, and we want to encourage people to participate rather than deter.
And it's also so important, we were talking about earlier, to make sure that lived experience is in the mix. Will that be made harder in terms of these criteria being proposed to have people who maybe have Gaelic and also have relevant experience for the charities that they want to help?
I think it's quite difficult to talk about it in a broad sense. It very often comes down to individual circumstances. So in a way, I'd rather not comment on that. But I think, as I was saying, it's about making it as open as possible to increase participation, but making sure that there's the safeguards in place, that the credibility of the organisation is also robust and sustained, both locally and in its dealings, if it works further afield.
Thank you, Convener.
Thank you, Emma. Vicky, I saw you nodding. No, you don't want to come in. Okay, thank you. Just before we move on to the next theme, I have a supplementary from Pam. Thanks.
Thank you, Convener. And it's you probably, those of you who heard the earlier session will have heard my kind of supplementary to this. I think I noted your answer, actually, Vicky, on the proportionality and that there are already mechanisms. It might be new, or it could be new, Madril, sorry. That there's already some mechanisms around finances. What do the panel think is the kind of appropriate compromise so that there isn't an onerous burden on charities to do checks on bankruptcy disclosure? Your comments, Madril, were really helpful on that as well. And how do we balance that with not putting people off applying? The default no was something that came up earlier on. And how do we balance that with the need to protect the integrity and the reputation of charities? Sorry, I know there's a lot in there. It's tricky. It's just, I feel like we need to do something, but what? So just if it's something you want to come back, the panel wants to come back to committee with in writing, then that's fair.
I mean, anything that doesn't bring too much cost and admin to charities would be a good solution. I don't know what that would be and where that would sit, but, you know, maybe a checking service of some kind that we could go to as charities. Don't know.
Thank you. Thank you. Did you want to come in, Vicky?
So in terms of the mechanisms and processes that are there, there's not a great deal of detail around what that would look like. But in terms of pulling that together, I think it's important that we minimise the amount of input that's required from charities in terms of where the burden is placed. Now, how that sits with the regulator and how the regulator then absorbs that within the existing functions that they have and how that would increase their capacity in terms of what they're able to produce and what they can provide for charities in terms of that supporting role, then that's something that really has to be considered in terms of that bigger picture. And so that conversation and discussion has to be held around how charities are able to provide the openness and transparency that they need, but equally that sits alongside making sure that those appropriate checks are there. So again, it's about having more of the detail around how processes would work and where we could minimise those processes. So, for example, using digital platforms, using existing mechanisms and trying to avoid the duplication or replication of existing work that already exists for charities in terms of the delivery of their outputs.
Thank you. I appreciate that. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Pam. We'll now move to questions from Miles.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning to the panel. Thank you for joining us today. I wanted to start with a question with regards to extending OSCA's powers to allow them to undertake inquiries into former charities and their trustees and what the panel's view was on that. Rami, will I start with yourself?
It's not an area I've given much consideration to, I have to say, but it seems to me if you take it from first principles, this is about public trust in charity as much as charities, and that would suggest to me that if there's a relevant inquiry for a former charity and former trustees, it would be appropriate for OSCA to undertake that.
Yeah. Anyone else anything to add? No. My second set of questions was in relation to issuing of positive directions for following inquiry work, and I think it's important what we picked up this morning in terms of burden being a real part of this we need to look at, and what you've touched upon, Vicky, in terms of supporting and providing guidance, not policing almost as a role. So I just wondered what the panel thought was appropriate for OSCA to be able to issue positive directions following inquiry work, and also I'm not sure showing the range of charities which maybe you support, but whether or not the panel believe it's appropriate for designated religious charities to be exempt from this provision as well. Does anyone want to come in on that?
We don't have any takers. Do you want to move to anyone specific, or are you? Rami, I think Rami could.
I mean, happy to come in on the point about positive directions. I mean, I think that is a sensible thing, because there are certain, I mean, inquiries are rare and should be rare. They occur when something's gone wrong. And so actually, this should be as much about fixing things and getting them right. So I think the principle of issuing positive directions is a good one that we welcome, knowing that it'll be used appropriately and where OSCA feel that there is something significant that has gone wrong.
Yeah, that's helpful. Thank you. And I think for smaller designated religious charities, it's something we want to sort of hear their views as well, if any involvement is there. There was also an issue with regards to connection to Scotland, which is now included, and just wondered where witnesses consider the requirement for charities to demonstrate a connection to Scotland is appropriate and an appropriate measure, and if there's any concerns over that.
I think Alzheimer's Scotland, we are widely supportive of the measure to have a connection to Scotland. I think that the connection to Scotland helps to focus OSCAR's role, ensuring that it's doing the work that has to be doing to support charities based in Scotland, providing services and resources in Scotland, and takes away from any potential diversion elsewhere. Charities are working under really challenging circumstances at the current time, and so any support and guidance should be there to support those particular charities in Scotland. As was mentioned at the earlier panel today, there has been a refocus and a shift around how the connection to Scotland is being looked at, and I think that is a really helpful and useful way to consider that connection to Scotland question in terms of focusing resources where they need to be.
Thank you. And the panel will have heard earlier my question in relation to powers which OSCAR could have to appoint interim trustees in specific circumstances where there's no trustee to be able to be found or not willing to act. And I wondered if the panel have any experience of this in their roles previously, or where you think that would be a helpful measure in a sort of emergency situation to support and stabilise a charity. We maybe need to do some more digging into where this has come from, but no one has anything to add on that. And then just finally, there's also a point with regards to maintaining a register of charity mergers and to make it easier for legacies to be transferred in a situation where the original legacy was made to a charity or has since merged or a charity's changed its name. Do you have any concerns or issues with regards to that, or is that a tidying up measure, as we've heard as well?
We certainly welcome that at CHAS, and we recognise that people often make wills many, many years before those wills might be executed, and sometimes there is a difficulty for executors in identifying the intended recipients of a legacy. So we would welcome that, and that if that helps reduce any ambiguity or reduce the need to test these things in the courts, then that would be very helpful. Charities rely hugely on legacies to be able to deliver services.
Is there anything we've not captured around that legacy issue which you think could have been improved, or is it straightforward enough? I know that increasingly we see charities looking towards that charitable legacy giving, and whether or not that will become a bit greater issue in the future, potentially with the impacts of this and potentially charities, fewer charities.
I mean, I think it is a very live question amongst charities as to how legacies might change in the years ahead as generational wealth has changed. But whether it's one where there's any answers in legislation, I'm not sure, but I could certainly reflect on that point and come back if there is.
Thank you very much. Thanks, Camina.
Thank you, Miles. And we'll move finally to Jeremy Balfour for his last set of questions.
Thank you, Camina, and good morning to you. Just going back to the questions I asked the previous panel, I mean, I suppose all of you are fairly, the three people in the room are all fairly large charities, but do you see additional costs coming for you in regard to the new proposals in the bill? Or do you think these will just be things that you're already doing anyway?
Vicky, would you like to come in?
Certainly the lack of detail means that it's difficult to assess fully the administrative and the financial burden that will be placed upon charities regardless of their size. However, I think it's inevitable that there will be additional administrative activity that has to go on in order to support the suggestions and proposals being put forward in the bill. So there will inevitably be a cost associated with the delivery of that. The ability of charities to be able to deliver that will be very much dependent on their structure and whether or not they can absorb it into their existing activity, or whether or not it would then have a further impact on their need to either fundraise or social alternatives in order to be able to meet that administrative burden.
Shona, can I ask you the question? Because obviously you're dealing with smaller charities. Are you concerned about the administration cost around this?
I think we're always concerned about the impact of additional requirements on small organisations, whether that's statutory or otherwise. And it's that balancing the requirements to be, you know, open, transparent, fit for purpose, with the capacity that the organisations have to deliver that. So that's, I think, always a perspective we have in mind when we ask for information. The degree of information we ask from the organisation does depend to some extent to the, or the detail we require varies according to the size of organisation. So it does concern me, but at this, because it depends on capacity to deliver and put that in place. And many of the organisations we deal with don't actually have employed staff. It's all done by volunteers. So anything that makes it more difficult for them to deliver their services and their purpose is challenging. I think sufficient support from OSCAR and SCVO have been praised for the work they do to help small organisations particularly would help offset that. So that's where I think the focus should be about how do those organisations support the very small organisations to deliver any additional requirements.
And Shirley, if I can just maybe follow up on that and say, would you then like to see some kind of financial limit? So if your charity is, say, below a certain figure, you wouldn't have to do the same amount of work as if you were a bigger charity. Do you think that could work in practice?
I think that would be well worth investigating further, because I think there is a degree of reporting that's required and that varies according to the size of the organisation. So I certainly would be interested in that.
And then my final question to the whole panel is, I mean, obviously we know that there's going to be a further review of charity law once this bill has been passed. But I'm just wondering, is there anything that you think should be in this bill that's not in the bill? So there's something that stands out you think that would make the life of my charity and my trustees easier?
I think there is an opportunity in the bill to just further clarify what the purpose of OSCAR is. It's very heavy on what OSCAR does, but it's also important to remember why OSCAR exists, and it's there for a very important purpose, which is should be to promote public confidence in charity generally. So it might be an opportunity for the bill to be amended to introduce a specific general duty on OSCAR to make sure that that's one of the things it does. And my view is that with regulators, it is important to be clear about why the regulator exists as well as what the regulator does.
Thank you.
Would anyone else like to come in on that specific point? I don't really want to put anyone on the spot. No. Vicky, yeah.
So in terms of the legislation, I'm a strong advocate of ensuring that the legislation that we look at is robust and absolutely sound. And I think ensuring that the legislation, the primary legislation, provides enough of a structure in order to hang any further secondary legislation or guidance on. So I think that whatever the final draft looks like, it has to be robust. It has to be able to provide that structure and that ability in order for the secondary legislation or subsequent guidance to be able to be followed up upon and for it to provide real clarity around what the purpose and what the intention is and most importantly, how it seeks to deliver that.
Thank you.
You don't have any further questions, Jeremy? No. Okay, to finish our questioning off this morning, then I'll move back to Deputy Convener Emma Roddick.
Thank you, Convener. I just wanted to go back to Shona because I know we've touched on quite a few different issues affecting specifically rural, island, Gaelic and small organisations. And I just wondered if there were any specific issues that she wished to raise today that we haven't touched on already.
I should thank you for the opportunity to do that. And I think I'll refer to what we put in our submission about encouraging the use of Gaelic in returns, in names of organisations and generally promoting awareness and understanding of Gaelic in Scotland. So that would be my other ask.
Top of it.
Thank you very much, Emma. So I really just want to take this opportunity to thank all the witnesses for your evidence this morning. What we've heard this morning will be very helpful in our scrutiny going forward. So thank you to everyone in the room and online. So that concludes our public business for today. Next week, we will continue to take evidence on the bill. We will now move into private. Can members who are joining us remotely please use the Microsoft Teams link in their calendars to join the meeting? And I close the public session. Thank you.